Let's take a look at an analog wave, which is typical what is found in electrical signal and radio waves. A wave can be seen in terms of a 300-degree circle. We see in this particular example of a wave, this would be the 0-degree starting point, and a quarter through the circle or the cycle, we've reached a 90-degree point. Then halfway through the circle or slash cycle, we reached a 180-degree point, and a complete circle or cycle is 360 degrees. So from starting point to the ending point, we complete the circle or the cycle. Okay, the height of the wave can be measured, and the height is known as amplitude. The length of the wave, or a complete cycle from start to finish, is known as wavelength. The top graph represents an analog wave. And we see as the signals, whether they are analog or digital, travel along a medium, that signal tends to break down or lose its original consistency, and we call that attenuation. And at some point, those signals will need to be regenerated. And we call that process amplification. Hence, you would need an amplifier to produce that effect. Okay, the bottom graph represents a digital signal. Digital signals are created when using pulses of as close to being as precise as possible voltages. And then in this instance, we could assume that this amplitude is 1 volt, and 1 volt is maintained for a period of time, and then the power generator no longer sends power, and we see that we get an absence of voltage for a certain period of time, and then the generator produces power again for a certain amount of time. And again, as with the analog signal, as the digital signal travels the media, it too will break down and will require some type of repeater slash amplifier. Okay. Well, at layer one of the OSI model, waves can be used by sending and receiving devices to send binary information. In this instance, amplitude modulation is used. We see that this bar represents zero voltage, and perhaps this could be 1 volt. So we see that a 1 volt signal will be interpreted as a 0, a 2 volt signal will be interpreted as 1, and then we go back to the 1 volt signals. We see that they are again interpreted as zeros. And note the dotted lines that separate the cycles. We could basically refer to the areas in between the dotted lines as time frames or time slots. In this instance, we see one complete cycle per time slot. However, the difference comes in when the amplitude is manipulated. This could be electrical wave, or this could be a radio wave. Okay, now if it's a radio wave, then the power in this instance wouldn't be an electrical signal, but a radio signal, and it will be measured in terms of power and hertz. Right, we can also use the frequency to relay zeros and ones. In this instance, again, we see the zero bar, and the dotted lines represent time frame. Okay. However, we see that in this particular example, an increase of a cycle changes the bit. So we have a relatively slow cycle, a longer waveform in this particular time frame, so therefore the receiving device will interpret that particular signal as a zero. We shorten the waveform or increase the cycle, the receiving device will interpret the signal as a one. Again, we slow the cycle, zero, slow the cycle, zero, maintain the slow cycle, zero, 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 increase the cycle, we get back to the one bit. Right? Zeros and ones can also be sent and interpreted based upon the phase of the wave. In this instance, we see that we start at zero, and we continue with the normal path of the wave, and the receiving device in this instance will interpret that path as a zero. But then if we shift directions or shift the phase, the receiving device will interpret the phase shift as a different bit, in this instance, one. Shift the phase again, back to zero, and we continue the cycle during each time slot, and we continue the zero bit pattern. Shift the phase, and we're back to the one bit. Right, so let's take a look at the return to zero. Okay, in this particular graph, we see the time slots are demarked by a solid gray line. Okay, again, we have the zero bar in this instance represents a zero voltage to produce one bit. We start at the upper range of the time slot, but halfway through the time slot, the signal returns to zero, basically no voltage. And then to produce another one bit, we have to start the voltage, positive voltage, that is, at the beginning of the next time slot. And halfway through that time slot, the voltage returns to zero, or no voltage. Again, we produce a one. To produce a zero bit at the beginning of the next time slot, we need to generate a negative one voltage. And halfway through that time slot, the signal returns to zero or no voltage. To produce a one. Again, we go with a positive voltage at the beginning of the time slot. But notice during each instance whether we're producing a positive voltage or a negative voltage at the beginning of the time slot. The voltage returns to zero or no voltage. Okay? That's returned to zero. Non-return to zero is different. To produce a one bit, we generate a positive voltage at the beginning of the time slot and maintain that voltage. Okay? And to produce a consecutive one, then we again we maintain the voltage. To produce a zero, we go through a negative voltage and at the beginning of the time slot, and we maintain that negative voltage until it's time to produce another bit. In this instance, it's the one, so we have to go to a positive voltage. In this instance, we need to produce consecutive ones, so we maintain the positive voltage until it's time to produce a zero bit. Then we go to negative voltage, maintain that negative voltage until it's time to produce positive voltage to generate a one bit. Okay. Okay. None return to zero is just what it says. At no point does the signal take a pause at the zero bar. Okay. There would be a positive voltage or negative voltage, but at no time a zero voltage. Okay, at the physical layer, yes, we are concerned with how devices communicate in terms of actually generating and sending the signals and interpreting the signals, but those signals have to travel some type of media. This is an example of physical media that's used to connect devices and to use as conduits to relay those signals. Okay. We see there's a 10 base T standard, has a maximum transmission speed of 10, which is 10 megabits per second. Hence the 10 in base equals 10 megabits per second. Base is baseband, which is different than broadband, and the T indicates twisted pair cabling is required for this particular standard. You can use Cat3 cable above, and each segment has a maximum distance of 100 meters. And it's best to use a connectivity device such as a hub or switch to produce the star topology. Okay. All right, let's take a closer look at the 10 base T. Standard requires a 10 megahertz frequency, and it uses the Manchester encoding scheme. Okay. Let's take a look at the Manchester encoding scheme. Okay. All right, we see that there are two Manchester encoding schemes. We're going to focus on the IEEE 802.3, which is Ethernet, and we note that the time frames or time slots are demarked by light, solid gray lines. Okay, right? To produce a one bit halfway through the time slot, we increase voltage, or we make a positive voltage. To produce one bit, we hold that positive voltage until halfway through the next time slot, we go to negative voltage. Okay, to produce one bit halfway through the particular time slot, we produce a positive voltage, okay, and so forth. Note that during this pattern, the bit indicator happens midway through the time slot opposed to at the beginning of the time slot. As in the case of the traditional non-return to zero. This is a non-return to zero type pattern. However, again, the bit indicator happens midway through the time slot. All right, continuing with the 10 base T standard. Okay. Again, it requires a minimum Cat 3 cable. A Cat 3 cable, Cat 5 cable have four pairs of wires. However, in regards to the 10 base T standard, two pairs are used. Okay. All right. In regards to the 100 base T 4 standard, it operates at 12.5 megahertz. It uses a different type of encoding scheme from 10 base T. And it has a data encoding scheme as well. Okay. It uses four pairs and it requires at a minimum Cat 3 cabling. The 100 base T4 standard is not currently in use. The flavor of 100 base currently used today is the TX. It operates at 31.25 megahertz. It uses the MLT-3 symbol encoding in addition to a data encoding scheme named known as 4B5B. Okay, uses two pairs and requires Cat 5 cabling. Let's take a look at the MLT-3 symbol encoding. Okay, you've had a few seconds to study the MLT3 scheme. We see it's a little more complex than the previous schemes. In this instance, to produce one bit at this particular time frame, there's a positive voltage. And notice what happens when the positive voltage in this instance is maintained. The next time frame will automatically be interpreted as a zero. So if we want to produce one bit after producing a zero in the third time frame, then we have to go to a different voltage level. In this instance, zero. And if we maintain the zero, the following bit will be interpreted as zero. Again, we've maintained the zero voltage. And the next bit will be interpreted as zero. To produce a one, we have to change the voltage. In doing so, we produce the one. If we want to produce a consecutive one, we have to change the voltage. And if we want to produce a third one, we have to change the voltage. But maintaining the voltage will be interpreted as a zero. Seen in this scheme. All right, under data encoding, we see that 100 base TX has a unique way of shuffling the intended bits before sending the bits across the media. And this unique code is known as 4B, 5B. Let's take a look at it. Okay. So if the sender needs to produce zero hexadecimal character, the sender generally would just send four zeros, which is the equivalent of zero in hex. However, if the sender is using 100 base T, then four ones and a zero will be sent. The receiver, on the other hand, will also be, in this instance, communicating via 100 base T. So the receiver would be aware that there's a unique coding pattern, and the receiver will have to interpret the 11110 as four zeros and relay the four zeros to the upper layers of the OSI model. Okay. To produce a hex character, generally without using a unique scheme, we would generate a 1010 bit pattern. However, if we're going to relay the A hex character to another device via 100 base T, then our device will interpret the 1010 as 10110, and the receiving device will receive this bit pattern and then interpret it as originally being 1010. Okay. Your text talks briefly as to why 100 base T employs the 4B, 5B encoding scheme. Okay. So 4B, we want to send 4 bits, but in essence, we'll send 5 bits. Okay. Okay. We can also send signals across Ethernet using 1,000 bits per seconds, or 1 gig. Actually, it's 1,000 megabits per second, and the frequency employed is 31.25 megahertz. It uses a 4D PAM5 symbol encoding scheme. Requires all four pairs of Cat5 cabling. Okay, again, that's 1,000 megabits per second. Okay, and let's take a look at 4D PAM5. Okay, 5 level pulse amplitude modulation, known as PAM5, uses 4 voltage levels. Okay. And each of the 4 voltage levels will represent 2 bits. Okay. We see in this example, the lowest voltage level will produce a 00 bit pattern. The next increased voltage pattern produces a 01. Okay. Okay, the third voltage produces a 10. Okay. And the fourth voltage produces a 1-1. So, and again, in this particular scheme, each voltage represents 2 bits. So in essence, we're sending two bits for the price of one signal. All right, at layer one, we also have to consider other types of cabling or media. For example, here we see that even within the coaxial domain, we have to be mindful of the megahertz to watt ratios per cable type. Okay. And also the attenuation patterns per cable type. Within the wireless domain, we have to be mindful of antennas and antenna connections. Okay. And, a Cisco access point may have a different connection than, let's say, a Netgear or some other type of device that's used for wireless connectivity. In terms of fiber, you see that fiber comes in a variety of forms. Okay. And we have to consider the fiber connectors. And fiber connectors vary as well. Also at layer one, we have to consider what type of cabling or media we want to use within the local area network, what standard is suitable for local area network, okay, what standard in terms of cabling, encoding, and connectors. Those standards may be different for what's required for LAN link or man links. Okay. Right, we have to consider connectivity between local area network devices that directly connect to the immediate connectivity device. In this instance, we have end devices such as printer, laptop, desktop, that are connected to a switch. Now, will the immediate connectivity link be the same or different as the link used to connect the immediate connectivity device to the next connectivity device? And we generally call the link that connectivity devices a backbone link, okay? There may be different requirements based on the needs of the organization, the ISP, or a major carrier. Also, we have to consider the topology, you know, the cabling connectors and signaling required for bus topology may be different and those required of a star topology, ring topology. But we do have to be cognizant of those issues before we set out to implement certain topologies.